Welcome, Mieke van Hemelrecht, to this spotlight conversation. And I wondered if, by way of introduction, you might tell us a little bit about your own background, how long you've been at King's, and indeed something of the main areas of research that you focus on.
Thank you. So I'm a cancer epidemiologist in the School of Cancer and Pharmaceutical Sciences. I've been at King's since 2008 when I started as a PhD student. And so now I'm a reader in cancer epidemiology, and I run a research group which is called TOUR, the Translational Oncology and Urology Research Group. And so we have two angles of work. So we do hardcore epidemiology, which is very much based at our computers, analyzing data, setting up studies, but then equally half of my team is actually in clinic consenting patients to various cancer studies and collecting samples and clinical data that we then use for research.
Great. Now, of course, the main focus of these conversations are in regard of work that's going on across the university in relation to coronavirus, and in particular, of course, the present pandemic. What's drawn you into that area of work from the background that you have?
Well, so I guess the cancer population, as we have heard through the what comes in the news, you know, they're people with a comorbidity, so they're potentially at a higher risk of getting corona, but equally they might get exposed to drugs that either suppress or activate their immune system, which as a result may also affect their COVID outcomes or their COVID risk. So there is, it's very much a need within our own clinical community. So my team works together with Guy's Cancer Center on a very regular basis. So I also co-lead Guy's Cancer Real World Evidence Program for the Trust. And so we deal with all the routinely collected clinical data. So obviously there is an opportunity there to look at our own data and see what happens in terms of oncological outcomes, but equally COVID outcomes for those patients who have both cancer and COVID. And mainly the driver for this is that, you know, this pandemic is new to everybody, and we have to make decisions on treatment changes, treatment delays, and we have very little information. So there is a need to share data and findings across the oncology community, not just within our own trust, but more nationwide and international. And so that's kind of really what started us working with our oncology colleagues.
Well, I was going to ask you, and I'm pleased to hear that you're working across not only nationally but internationally, but do you want to tell us a little more about how those networks are really functioning in terms of bringing data together? And of course, in this instance, we really need that data to come together very quickly.
Well, so I think there is various levels to bringing data together. So our priority at the moment is sorting out our own data in our own cancer center, because sadly, you know, London is at the epicenter of the epidemic in the UK, but even within London, Southeast London is at the center of the epidemic. So at the moment, we already have over 140 cancer patients that are COVID positive. So we really first want to look at our own data to kind of inform our clinical practice within the trust, but then our next step is indeed to then liaise, because there is various initiatives pan London as well as nationwide in terms of data collection. So once we have optimized the data collection in our, you know, because it's also automating the systems, doing the quality control of all our data, we want to be absolutely certain that what we have is of good enough quality, and then we can share it nationwide. Now, from an international point of view, through various colleagues at KCL, I've been put in touch with, for instance, the European Institute of Oncology in Milan. So our next step is, apart from looking at our own data in London, we would also like to compare our data in terms of outcomes with Milan, because it's a different healthcare system, but also they're at a different stage of the pandemic. So that's the next step. And so we've been in touch with the epidemiologists in Milan to make sure that we collect the same data in the same format. So that's something that will happen in the future. And then another thing at the level of international collaboration. So our colleague Richard Sullivan has set up a task force, which will become more publicly well known in the next few days, where we really bring together people from all over the world covering both high income and low and middle income countries, specifically with a focus on cancer and COVID, because apart from the work that I've just described in terms of clinical and oncological outcomes, there is obviously also the issue of screening. Screening activities are not happening for cancer, so we already see in all countries quite a substantial drop in the number of cancer cases that get diagnosed, which obviously will hit us further down the line because we will diagnose more people with more advanced stage straight away. And then there is also the whole effect of the society and the economical impacts that will happen, you know, once we kind of go back to normal after the pandemic.
Whatever normal might look like at that point. And thank you for referencing the issue of not only those who are diagnosed also having coronavirus, but the impact this is having on diagnostics for cancer more generally. Mika, we're almost out of time, but I wondered if you might just offer a reflection of what you feel has been the outstanding aspects of King's College London's response to the COVID pandemic.
So I think it's perhaps two things. It's one thing, obviously, is from a research point of view. I think the collaborations that we have between the university and the trust are just fantastic, you know, and very much showing that we are a comprehensive cancer center and academic health science center. The collaborations, it's, you know, we have actually produced the first paper on our analysis within a week time, where we had conversations going back and forward between the academics and the clinicians. So I think from that point of view, this is only going to benefit us going forward. And then I guess more from a way of how we're supporting staff, I personally am very impressed with how the university is supporting all the staff and creating all the various activities. And I think that is equally important because, you know, having a team with more than 20 people, it's important to kind of get that connection and make sure that they feel supported and can kind of drive their research activities. So to me, those are like two very important results from the pandemic.
Well, look, Mika van Hemelrijk, thank you so very much for spending some time with us. And may I also thank you and your team for all the work you're doing. Thank you.